Hi, everybody. How are you doing today? Let's see what's going on with the mic here. Got that worked out? Well, I want to thank everybody for coming out to our, I guess this is our fifth in our lecture series here on AI. And right from the start here, though, we're gonna introduce someone new here. This is Roopnath. He has a company called, let me see now if I can remember. It is Relishy, and it's an AI-related startup. And I'm going to hand it right over to him right now. Here you go.
Hi everyone, good evening. Just wanted to say, like, I was a member of Dojo here for the last 2 years, so it's very nice to present here to share more details about the company. Relishy, what we're doing is we help develop voice assistants as a service for businesses. I'm Roopnath Grandhi, founder and CEO of Relishy. Let me tell you a little bit about more about myself. So my expertise has been in AI and machine learning. My thesis is in AI. And I've been working last 15 years for several companies, including eBay, developing large scale AI systems. I have multiple patents in machine learning and e-commerce space. So before telling a little bit about the problem we are solving here at Relishy, I want to touch base a little bit about the current landscape on voice-based platforms. So if you look at the last 2 years, the smart speaker adoption has increased significantly at a rapid pace from 1% 2 years back to 20% of US adults owning either Alexa or Google Assistant. That's about 50 million devices. So with this, every business has to really seriously start thinking about how do they provide and use this voice as a medium to let their users communicate to their brand or business. So what is the problem? I mean, there are a lot of Alexa devices being sold and many people are buying, and it seems like everything is good, but really, like, apart from listening to music or asking simple questions, when is the last time you had a really amazing voice experience talking to your business or getting information on these new voice platforms? So I'm assuming most of us haven't seen, or it's no. Right? So why is this a hard problem? Understanding voice-based queries is very hard. So I'm not here really talking about speech-to-text. Most of these platforms inherently have speech-to-text. They're offering it for the developers. So I'm really talking here about how do we take the text that's coming out from speech-to-text and really understand what the user is talking about. And if we really map it, like how flexible the voice queries can be, that you're giving your users the flexibility to talk to your business, versus the kind of technology the business has to implement to be able to provide that amazing voice experience. So as the flexibility increases, it's exponentially becomes harder to really provide compelling voice experiences. Let's take a simple example. Let's assume you're going to a birthday party in an hour and you want to give a gift to your nephew. And you want to, like, an ideal thing is, hey, you have Alexa at home, you can just speak to it, hey, I'm going to a birthday party, can you recommend me a gift on my way to the party, right? So you think, like, that's a simple question you're asking, and if that, and Alexa should be able to easily help you, right? But most businesses doesn't have the technology to even support this basic query. right? For example, let's take Target and even Amazon. So if you actually type this query in both the websites, you can see the results are not very relevant, because most of these technologies are using keyword-based technology, which is like a two-decade-old technology. And we have been continuously improving, optimizing the ranking and everything, but fundamentally, the way we try to understand the conversation or the intent, most of these are legacy technologies. And there's significant effort that businesses have to take to be able to change the experience. So what is the solution? So Relishy has been working hard on this problem last few years, and we have developed a very robust platform to integrate businesses. So for example, if it's a retailer or commerce business, to integrate with our platform, we pull in all the data like click, purchases, the catalog, and everything. And apart from that, we also have a comprehensive, robust crawling system that crawls hundreds of thousands of sites and builds a deep knowledge graph in the vertical that particular business is in, so that we can provide compelling voice-based experiences. So using this data, we have, using our AI stack, which includes deep learning, the knowledge graph, and natural language understanding, not only we power the voice-based experiences like Alexa, Google Assistant, but we can also power their website search and other conversational channels that users will be communicating to that brand. Let's take a simple example. Let's assume a user is looking for a red dress, going for a beach wedding party, right, under a specific range. So using our system, we are able to accurately break down this particular query into micro intents using our NLP and natural language understanding. But not only that, if you look at the product, like nowhere in the product, it's in the title, description, or metadata, it doesn't have any information to say that this dress is actually suitable for beach wedding party. But this is the kind of experience users are looking for when they're talking to voice assistants, where you understand the 100% of the intent, not 70% or 60%, right? So using our knowledge graph and deep understanding of what the user intent, we're able to accurately match the products in this particular case. So using this technology, we primarily operate this as a SaaS model. We provide this as a service for businesses using monthly subscription fees. We charge based on API call volume. And that's it. So traction, so we are primarily focusing on very few key verticals right now, e-commerce and education. So we have multiple paying customers in these verticals. And we have powered so far about 200 million API calls, and we have about 20 million shopping intents in our knowledge graph. And typically, our customers, when they integrate with our technology, they see 30% lift in conversions. And we're also launching a Shopify store voice assistant in this Q4. That's it, thank you. So just to conclude, I mean, we have a strong pipeline of customers who are eager to integrate our technology. We are looking for engineers to join our team. If any of you are interested, definitely you can ping me this email, or I'll be here after the talk. You can just want to ask any questions or want to chat, be happy to. Thank you.
Okay. First, I want to tell you a little bit about Hacker Dojo. I don't know how many of you have never been here before, but I just want to give you a little bit of a background on what we're about. We're about, obviously, you know, inspiring innovation and creativity. And Hacker Dojo is it's a voluntary service, but most of the people come here, and it's a place to be. It's a place to meet other people. But more recently, we're switching over into becoming more like a stepping stone to an incubator or something like that. We're becoming much more startup oriented. We now have something called, I think it's Tech Ventures, that's going to be part of our Tech Futures is going to be part of our process here. Okay, a co-working space, it's a maker space, and it's an event space. So if you became a member of Hacker Dojo, you'd have access to these rooms, and you just simply sign up and you say, I want to do an event. You want to do a meetup here or something like that. This is our continuing lecture series here. Now, today we have Rama from IBM, but next week we're going to have natural language processing. The speaker is Saket Joshi from Amazon. And then 2 weeks from now, we're going to have Shilpa Kohatar from NVIDIA. And lastly, we're going to have somebody here from Accenture. Shilpa is going to be talking about deep learning for beginners. And then we have chatbots and virtual assistants. So we got a lot of stuff coming up here on the horizon. Hope to see you guys again in future events. And today we are having Rama Akkiraju from IBM, and tell you a little bit about Rama. She's got a master's in computer science and MBA from New York University. Leads the Mission of People Insights at IBM's Watson division. Featured in Forbes and Fortune as one of the top influencers in AI. 40 technical papers, 20 patents, and recipient of multiple awards on her papers on AI and operations. So let's give her a hand. Do the transition here.
Thank you for being here, and thanks to Hacker Dojo for inviting me. So today I thought I would tell you about the work that I do at IBM, Watson division, share some best practices for building business applications that involve AI-enabled services. So this is an intimate enough audience, so I thought I would first show a couple of videos and throw a quiz. And then we'll get started. I hope the sound will play.
Ever since people started recording information,
So that was Xerox commercial in 1977. Now I want to show the latest one that Xerox put out 40 years later. Okay, so here comes the quiz. So what is this, what are these commercials about? What are they saying about how the world has changed in these 40 years and how businesses do their work and how global companies have become? Guesses? I think I kind of gave away the answer more or less, but anybody want to comment on what these commercials are about? Yeah? That's absolutely, yeah, wonderful, insightful. Another, yeah?
We have gone into extensive study on this particular domain, where there are scholars who go on contract to the Greek version or the Italian version, etc., of documents which are hand transcribed some from some original, where mistakes happen, any mistakes happen. And to be able to do a simple NLP, there's nothing NLP, it's not that simple anymore at that time, so the context has to be understood. And the meaning could be different. Sometimes they overrode, you know, all these biblical and other religious scriptures.
Absolutely. Anybody else? Yeah?
So about the question of processing and spreading information.
Okay. Any other comment?
You say personalization.
Personalization? Yeah. So all these themes are actually quite relevant that I wanted to call out. One is, as you know, the commercial started out with monks who used to take these sacred texts and make copies of it, right? And in olden days, people used to, and I have to thank, first of all, credits to a person, P.K. Agarwal, who recently called my attention to these Xerox advertisements, that commercials that came out, and in one of his talks. So I thought it would be very useful to actually use this as a starting point for discussion to my talk as well. So credits to him for calling my attention to these. In olden days, so what people used to do is to take these sacred texts and make copies of it. And a lot of times, these monks they added their own interpretations of it, and if they didn't like the text, they ended up changing it, and so there was a lot of interesting things got introduced over the years, and you know, the trust associated with the translation of or transcription of that content eroded over time. People could not tell if this is really the original or not. So one point that I wanted to call out is about trust. Another one is, as years passed, the requirements changed. It's not only about transcribing that whatever text in whatever language and faithfully and distributing those copies. It's also about translating it into so many different languages. And as you do that, how do you do that faithfully, and how do you do that with great fidelity, right? So translations into multiple languages is also another issue. So trust, translation, and the global nature of spreading information and dealing with information. And that's what AI systems today have to deal with as well. When you build an AI model or an application or a voice assistant type of applications that Roopnath was talking about, it's not just in English that you have to work with. Initially, it may be English that you would start with, but pretty soon you would have to be able to answer those questions about that, you know, beach wedding red dress under 80 into many languages. So, and your intent recognition system has to understand that intent in many different languages, and people may use different contexts, cultures, and their interests and personalizations may be different, and in some cultures they may prefer long dress, in some cultures they may prefer a short dress. How do you know all those things? And AI systems have to really understand all of these aspects, and that's what I wanted to call out with these advertisements. So now let's get back into the presentation. So my name is Rama Akkiraju, as was introduced, and I hope this shows up properly. Is okay for you? Yeah. All right, so I work at the IBM Watson division, and I lead the AI operations mission. So what does AI operations mean is the first question I get. AI operations means making AI work for enterprises. What does that mean? Let's find out. So here is a comic relief for you, a bit of it, before we get into the intense talk. So yeah, this is your machine learning system. Yep, you pour the data into this big pile of linear algebra, then collect the answers on the other side. What if the answers are wrong? Well, just stir the pile until they start looking right. Well, I will come back to this. This is somewhat actually a true statement of where deep learning and AI is in general. People don't know how to interpret the answers and why the AI systems give the answers they give. And there are a lot of interesting questions that it raises on what it means to build AI-enabled applications that are in production in enterprises, especially in domains like legal domains and compliance domains. Can you just take the answers that it gives for granted? So I'll come back to this question. Keep thinking about it in the background. So what are some of the AI applications that companies are building these days? Roopnath talked about one. Here are some other examples. Digital assistants, chat bots, doctor's assistants in healthcare domain, legal assistants to help attorneys do the legal research for their cases, social media monitoring so that you can do more personalized type of recommendations, and face detection, image recognition, those types of things that are becoming more and more prevalent in our day-to-day lives. So these are all examples of AI applications that companies are building. But what are the building blocks that power the development of these AI applications? There are this foundational set of AI capabilities that are needed in order to build those types of AI applications, right? And these are Roopnath alluded to it. It's about understanding the intent. What, when you say that it's about red dress, beach wedding, and such, you really are trying to understand the intent that it's a party, right? It's a celebration that's happening. Therefore, you probably wouldn't recommend a black dress, right? So that kind of intent understanding is natural language understanding. Understanding what is being said, what are the entities, what are the named entities, and what is the sentiment, what is the tone. What are the relations, and these are the kind of things that are expressed in text that you want to have a good understanding of. Then, for having a natural conversation with all these applications, speech to text, text to speech, these are also building block AI models or services, you could call them. Then things such as language translation, right? When a document is given in one language, how do you translate it automatically into another language and the technology that's required for it? Given a set of images, being able to classify that this is an image of a cat or a dog or a person wearing a red dress and those sort of things. Then conversations, right? So these are starting to elevate the discussion to the next level from the building blocks to being able to carry on a conversation between a human and a computer bot, and what that means, you know, having an understanding of the intent, having an understanding of what is the response, most likely response in this situation, and framing that conversation thread. Understanding the tone, sentiment, emotions, and understanding people's personality traits. These are all kind of AI services that power these applications. So at Watson, we build all these building block services, and if you go to, you know, Watson web page and check out, you'll see all these as services that you can call, invoke, start using in building your applications, and same thing with several other companies, right, with Google, Microsoft, and others. So the question is, okay, so let's say I'm a company who is building an AI-enabled application, and I want to use one of these building block services to build these applications, right? The chat bots, the legal assistant, doctor's assistants, and social media monitoring tools, and so on. How do I go about actually using those things, build my applications? If I take the general purpose set of models that are built, would they work for enterprises? And we have found it, interestingly, the hard way, that they don't. And a lot more work needs to be done to make them work for enterprises. And I hope you'll find this valuable, the set of best practices that we came up with after stumbling to take those building blocks and enable these applications, all the things that went wrong and all the things that we had to do to make them work. And in many ways, we are still, you know, working towards making them work and get better and better every day. So that's the bridge part, to go from these building blocks to building these real world applications. What are the things that we need to do? So, okay, so let's start at the beginning. A very good place to start, right? Many of these building block AI services are machine learning services, if not all of them. And you know, they learn from data, right? Data is the fuel, algorithms are the engine. So you feed them with a lot of labeled data. So you take pictures of cats and dogs, label them as, this is a picture of a cat, this is a picture of a dog, or you take a bunch of sentences and say, this is the intent of celebration, this is an intent of somebody who is expressing complaint, and you take a bunch of those and feed it in. So it takes this labeled data, be it images, be it text, be it speech. In the case of speech, you take an audio sample and then you transcribe it exactly, align it for minute to minute, frame to frame, and you give that to the system and say, hey, here is the audio and here is the corresponding text. Now learn from it the patterns and model so that you can take a new unseen audio file and transcribe it and convert it to text, right? So that's what we are talking about in machine learning. So it takes a lot of labeled data, and when it learns, it states that it graduated, and you are now starting to make use, you put that model in production, and it starts to make predictions. One of the things that we have to understand when we talk about AI services, especially those are machine learned, is that more likely than not, it takes multiple iterations to get them right. So because data is noisy, they're going to learn models and patterns, but the accuracy of the predictions that they make will not be 100%. So you give it 100 images of dogs and cats, you ask the model to make a prediction after you train the model, it may get it 90% of the time right, but it'll get 10% of the time wrong. So its accuracy only is 90%. Now in real world applications, that kind of accuracy may or may not be acceptable. So what do you do? How do you bridge the gap? I mean, 90% is actually a pretty good one. Most companies will take that, but usually we don't even get there. We are somewhere hovering between 70 to 80, and you know, it's a very hard problem to get it to get to 90% accuracy. But let's say you got there. Still, companies want to do better. They want to use these systems to rely on mission critical, business critical types of applications. So how do we get there? I'll talk about that bridge in a bit. But so what goes into that building, you know, here I showed this, you know, the system is learning. How does it actually learn? What are the steps that happen? This is, I would call it a part of a life cycle of building an AI model, not the full cycle. So the cycle starts, actually doesn't start here. There are other steps, but let me start here and then I'll tell you the steps that come before it in a bit. Data collection and preparation, okay? So first thing is to collect the data that you need to train the model with, prepare it, and the preparation requires, you know, a lot of cleaning, making sure that you have access to the rights of, associated with the data and all that, enriching the data with, by, that is annotating it, labeling it. Then you make sure you store the data, don't lose your training data. You analyze it to see how much of what labels you have. So if you're training a system with cats and dogs, you make sure you have, say, maybe even distributions of labels for cats and dogs. Or maybe because of the way you're collecting the data, because of what the access that you have for the data, maybe you only have the distribution that, you know, 80 of the images are cats and only 50 of the images are dogs, and maybe that's what you have, and that's what you're training with. And that leads to a bunch of biases that the model will learn because you're not providing it with exact even distributions of data. But that may or may not, that may be okay or may not be okay, but you need to, you may not be able to do anything about it because that's the amount of budget or that's the amount of access to data that you have at a given point in time when you train a model, so you just have to live with it. But at least know and analyze the data and know what you're feeding into the model so you know what it is learning and what it's going to get back, right? So those are all the steps related to data collection and preparation. Then the feature preparation comes. So this is where you're trying to understand what are some of the critical aspects in the data that that are likely to help the model to learn patterns. And one could argue that in a deep learning type of an algorithmic setting, it would automatically learn the features. That may be true, but it always helps even for a deep learning model to be able to give some features to speed up the process. Typically, a training lead does that, and there are a several set of things that you do depending on the type of data you have. Whether it's a text data, speech data, or image data, you do feature preparation differently. In the case of text, you may have to tokenize the text, and the tokenization is very different in different languages. In English, maybe space delimitation works for tokenizing text, whereas in Korean, space is optional. So you have to have different kinds of techniques for tokenizing it. Part of speech tagging and understanding of what are the different things that are being said, from a syntactic parse point of view, from a semantic point of view, these are all language dependent type of things. So a lot of interesting work in NLP space in this area, but basically you need all of these kind of tools at your disposal to prepare text features or image or speech features. In the case of speech, you would have to work with the phonemes, the phonemes, the sounds in each language and their corresponding representations to alphabets and such, which goes into feeding, into training a speech to text recognition system. And so on. So feature preparation. And these days, you know, there are a lot of advancements in feature preparation where you have what are called word embeddings that are being already pre-trained and being released as a set of features that you can use in the case of text-based data. So companies, several of you may know, companies, Stanford, Facebook, others, and have pre-trained these word embeddings. Basically, these are representations of vectors for words in multiple dimensions, 300 dimensions, 500 dimensions, that can be used for feature representation. Then comes the model training. So you've prepared your features and you have to now start to design the architecture of what kind of algorithms you would use and what is the configuration of that algorithms, whether it's an SVM or you use naive Bayesian one or you use deep learning. If so, how many layers, what are the hidden layers, and what is the final layer like, and all of these kinds of decisions that that a training lead, typically a data scientist, somebody who's with machine learning background, does. And it's a very iterative process throughout. There may be dictionaries or rules that you may have to feed in. No matter how good you do with the system, there is always some kind of edge edge case handling that needs to be done, because these are long tail type of samples that their patterns need to be taken into account. The model may not have the privilege to learn them well because there are not enough data samples for those long tail cases. So that's what a training lead does, prepares a model. The outcomes of this is a model. Then the service development and package lead takes that model and actually packages it so that it can run as a REST service running on a cloud, so that it can be invoked, and it has certain performance non-functional requirements, specifications that it has to abide by, and it has to be able to take enough load, and it has the capability to scale up and down and deal with the load and all of that. So that's what the service packaging development lead does, and eventually it is deployed. And before it's deployed, it goes through a bunch of testing. And testing is all about checking how well this model does on different data sets. So traditional software and AI models are very, very different. And I can take you through some of the differences, and I have some articles, blog articles on my LinkedIn page. You're welcome to check those things out. But they're very different in the sense that when you build a software, traditional software application, let's say that does 2 + 3 = 5, it's accurate most of the time. It's accurate. It better be, unless it has defects, it's accurate. It's 100%, right? It's working, and you write a test case, and you know that it worked when it passes that test case by returning the exact answer. In the case of a statistically trained machine learned model, the model is not necessarily going to be 100% accurate in the initial iterations, and or maybe never. It may asymptotically reach that 100% accuracy, but it may not be. So on any given data set, its performance will vary. So on one data set, it may have accuracy of 80%. On another data set, it may have an accuracy of 90%. On something else, it may have an accuracy of only 50 or 60%. It depends on what the model learned and what its strengths and weaknesses are and what it's being tested in the test data set. So it's very important to test an AI model before it goes out on various kinds of test data sets, including competitors, APIs, and all that, to establish a good baseline, and also on what is its mean accuracy and what is the confidence interval like when you test it. And again, even that is applicable only to the test data sets that you test. And you still don't know whether it will work in real world or not. When you actually deploy it and customers start testing it on their own data sets, and you have never seen anything like that, you have never added any of that kind of data either in your training data set or testing data set, then the model, you have no idea what the model will do. So a lot of testing needs to be done. It gets deployed, and that's not where the life cycle of it ends. It's a continuous loop. Yes, in a traditional software development too, there is a continuous improvement cycle, but that's mostly driven by new requirements or requirement changes. Whereas in the case of a machine learning system, you have no choice but to keep on continuously iterating, because you start out with a less than 100% accuracy, so the model has to learn. And a lot of times what happened in the real world when they started deploying some of these AI models is that the expectations were up here. They say, oh, wow, AI, that's it, let's go, let's build out these chatbots. They're going to answer all the questions for people. The expectations were up here. People did not realize that, or companies did not realize that, the first iteration of the model is not going to be good enough, or maybe barely good enough. And you have to bridge that gap to your threshold levels of acceptance for that model to be in production by continuously iterating it and improving it with the customer's own data in their own domain, right? So let me give an example of a speech-to-text system. Let's say that gets trained in with the US accented English audiences audio files, and we tested it, we put it to a lot of testing, and we say, okay, great, it's at 5% word error rate. That means it's 95% accurate. That's pretty much as good as humans can do with speech to text. And so that we have achieved human parity. We declared success, and we said our speech-to-text systems are now ready for businesses, okay? A company in Australia uses our speech-to-text system and says, oh my God, this is at 50% accuracy, because it is not understanding the Australian accents of people. It's not trained with it. And it starts to fall apart. And the same thing happens when a customer in UK, although it's English, there is a Southern accent, there is UK accent, there is Australian accent, there is Indian accent, and it starts to fall apart, right? That's what happens to these AI systems when you deploy them in real world. Now, what needs to happen, and that's, I'm not necessarily saying that that's bad, but that's a starting point, right? So companies who are using these have to now start to realize that it takes a lot of hard work to make these things work for their enterprises, and that hard work is all about teaching these systems your language, your vocabulary, your data, your own context. And when you do that, they'll improve. Over time, they're improving. So what that means is one of the requirements for these AI services when anybody builds them is to make sure that they are actually extensible. As in, it's not what you build the first time around is not going to be the final model. It's going to have to be able to take more data and continuously improve on top of the base model, right? And that's very important. So these AI models or services have to be extensible, and they have to be able to take additional data to improve. So I kind of alluded to this point and that said that this is really not the starting point for building any AI model. Really, the starting point starts up here. You know, I really want to treat this as a continuous cycle, same thing like the previous chart, but I'm showing the steps here. People get in and start building AI models. Say, we have had customers who would want to explore and experiment with our AI systems and build chatbots, and they would experiment with them. As soon as they deploy in one language, they would immediately start asking for another language and so on. First of all, we ourselves don't have our AI models in all those languages. So that's a constraint. Yes, we have to, when we build models, we have to train them in all these different languages, and like in the Xerox commercial. And that's a big challenge. And our customers who are using these speech-to-text systems and natural language understanding systems and all of these services, they need to now build their AI applications that they are building in all these different languages. So you don't just jump in saying, okay, I'm going to build an AI application here for solving this problem. First, start to think about, okay, what is my starting point? What are my priorities? What are all the languages that I want to be in? And what are my performance targets? Don't set an expectation that it has to be at 99% or 100% accuracy. Set realistic expectations, but set expectations and thresholds saying, I'm not going to deploy it if it is below certain threshold. And that may or may not be achievable. At least you will know whether you can build a realistic production-ready system or not, right? And it takes a lot of time and effort to procure data and funds. So in the case of us, the perspective that I'm giving is as IBM, the developer of these AI building block services. And the perspective that some of you may want to take is you as an entrepreneur or a company who is trying to build AI applications using these building blocks, right? So there are different perspectives here. I'm telling you the story from our perspective of building these building block services, but I will connect it to you as the users when you build your own applications using these types of building block services. What are the considerations that you have to have, right? You may have your own data that you want to train the system with, so you may not have the problem of procuring funds to acquire data. We do when we build our base models, but you still have the problem of whether you have that data or not. We run into this problem all the time where, especially in financial services companies, one part of the organization wants to build a call center analytics solution, and they have the charter to build this call center analytics solution for another division. That another division is the one that's actually the line of business that has all this call center data that comes to their banks. They are not legally allowed to let that data get out of their immediate organization. So even this other organization who is trying to build this call center application will have to go through a bunch of approvals and this and that and a lot of hurdles to acquire that data in order to train this application. So data is a huge, huge topic in building any type of AI application. It brings with it the governance aspects, the legality aspects, the quality aspects, the term conditions aspects. There might be terms and conditions based on which you may have to delete data, and you may have to delete data that is specific to particular individuals. So you have to be able to query the data that you are training an AI system at that level and keep track of it for compliance and governance aspects. So having processes and methods and tools for dealing with all of these pre-preparatory steps is so important. And none of this is in any general discussions that happen in any type of AI conference. Everybody talks about deep learning algorithms. Everybody talks about, you know, the next best algorithm that they have and in machine learning. And the actual narration in the general population of, in the community of AI is completely missing these critical aspects of all the hard work and all of these are interesting things that need to be done before you actually come to the point of training an AI system. And by the way, all of these steps, the tools and methods that you need to prepare data, to collect, to process it, and to govern it, themselves need a lot of AI models. So it's AI for data, data for AI, and it's a recursive thing. You need to bring in a lot of AI algorithms to be able to deal with all this data quality management, and I'll tell you more about that. So the main thing that I wanted to call out here is the fact that there is a lot of things that have to happen before you can get to the point of training an AI system. It's not, or even improving an AI system that you may, AI service or a model that you may buy or you may use from any company or vendor. So now I'll share with you some of the best practices that we came up with based on our own experience and expertise. Managing the data pipeline thoughtfully and consciously is extremely important in building AI services, models, applications. Data is the biggest elephant in the room. Where do you get the data from? Who is supplying you the data? Are you collecting data from fair, unbiased sources? Do you have licenses for that data? Are you storing that data? Are you actually properly have access controls for that data, governing that data? How much did it cost me to acquire that data? All of these things, you know, and how much time did it take or does it take to collect data? All these things are very important. Companies go in and say they want to build and deploy a chatbot or a call center analytics application in 3 months. So they set a target for themselves. But if you, first thing you have to set a target for is how long does it take? What are the lead times for each of the activities in the life cycle of building the first iteration of an AI model? You have to first take that into account before you set that, because a lot of times, if you have your own data that you are using to improve this AI model, that's fine. But even there, preparing the data takes a lot of time. But if you have to acquire data, it takes a lot of time. There are vendors, there is a full ecosystem to supply data for AI, including crowd platforms like Amazon's Mechanical Turk and Figure Eight, and which used to be defined Crowdflower, and there are other vendors. There are many companies in these days to supply you with data, or even workers who can label the data for you. But all of those things take time, months of time, whichever way. So you have to take that and plan for it. So the point is, data is the new oil, but oil ain't cheap. You know, the another thing is that it costs a lot of money to acquire data to build AI systems. So I'm just giving example here. To build a good speech-to-text system in one language, it takes 10,000 hours of data. and those 10,000 hours of data have to be transcribed by humans manually. That's the magic behind building an automated speech-to-text system. There isn't a good magic. It's a lot of hard work. And the 10,000 hours ain't coming cheap. And if you just pull it off the YouTube and internet and TED Talks, this and that, you're in trouble if you want to do business legally. You have to make sure you acquire that data by all legal means. You cannot scrape. And it costs a lot of money depending on the type of data that you're building. So your cost could be anywhere from, you know, 17 million to 220 million if you want to build one language model, English, let's say, speech to text. If you want to now take that to build another one for German, Japanese, French, Chinese, each one adds up these millions of dollars. That's what it takes. By the way, how much do you pay when you use a speech to text service? Does anybody know? If you call an API for a speech to text? Yeah, it's pennies. So this is actually a very tough business to be in. Users pay pennies per 1 minute of audio, and the upfront costs to building these are huge. Return on investment won't come for, you know, foreseeable future. Tough business to be in, AI business. Natural language understanding services are not far behind, but you know, they also require huge amounts of data to label data, and it costs. The data has to be collected from, you know, different sources, news articles, websites under fair use conditions. You get the data, you give it to different folks to label it. Do you think this is a positive sentiment? Do you think this is a negative sentiment? Do you think this is an entity as in a place or a person? Lot of hard work, just plain old humans sitting and labeling it. And there is a lot of automation that's happening to label it, to use semi-supervised or unsupervised techniques for labeling data and all of that. But even that requires, you know, monitoring to make sure that it's of good quality, which is done by humans. So AI has a lot of humans in the loop. There was a question there? So that is, the barriers to entry are high for several of the services, especially for speech to text. But what companies are doing, see, this is what 10,000 hours is what it takes to build a robust system, speech to text system, that understands natural language. Now, if companies like Roopnath, Relishy, if he only cares about a particular domain in retail, and say, you know, it only needs to understand this vocabulary, you are really scoping the problem down, and it may not need to understand the entire, you know, language and a, you know, any kind of thing that you can say under the sun. It's a very constrained domain. Then you can reduce the problem size and the scope and the data requirements down. So most companies, if they are not big giants like the five or six who actually have the capability to acquire data and to build these speech-to-text systems, Nuance, Google, IBM, and a few others, and in each domain, Microsoft and a few others, they specialize in domains. So they don't build the full-base systems. They actually build very special-purpose speech recognition systems that work in IoT, command and control. So, you know, turn the headlights on, turn the wipers on, turn the wipers off. These are very controlled set of command type of text sentences that you can train within that control domain, and the costs for that are low. So that's why you see more companies kind of going that way and specializing as opposed to, you know, the full breadth in all languages and so on. So I'll actually talk more about what, and in fact, that's the insight, right? That's the insight that we've gained that, in order to, I might as well go there to talk about it, right? So if you want to solve everybody's problem in the world, it costs way too much, and it takes too long, and it requires too much data, and only a few companies can afford to do that. But you start to narrow the problem down, then see, if the x-axis is the amount of training data that's needed, and y-axis is the accuracy, in this particular case, precision, a typical learning curve goes like this. As you add more and more data, its precision increases. That's what you would expect. But you know, the amounts of data that's required to reach those levels that you want to be at are very large for real world applications. But you can kind of start to cheat by saying, I'm going to write different learning curves. So I'm going to narrow the problem and say, okay, I have a base model that may not be performing at this level of accuracy, but it's over here. But that's okay. I'm now going to start the problem, shift the problem to solving this problem. I have decent enough base upon which I can now actually build a specific industry model. And so if you build something that works only for retail, for example, to understand about dresses and you know, the beach wear and those kind of things, your domain is now constrained, so you can start to ride a different learning curve. And if you're now a particular customer, your domain is even further more narrow because you have very specific vocabulary and use cases that you're trying to solve this AI for. And you can now learn a different learning curve, so you can reach the levels of accuracies that you want with smaller amounts of data faster. Question there? Oh no, algorithms with data, but probably not as much data as you would have liked and to solve the generic problem. So let me give an example. A few, couple of months ago now, Google's CEO Sundar Pichai in one of their conferences demonstrated a voice, digital voice assistant for two scenarios, making restaurant reservations and salon reservations. You might have heard that, and that was in the news and a big news. Why do you think they only demonstrated those two use cases? Very narrow. Very narrow use cases, right?
Return on investment.
Return on investment. Yeah. Yeah. Right. So it's too hard a problem to solve for natural language communication. Right? So you break the problem down, divide and conquer. You take a smaller problem that you can reasonably solve with smaller amounts of data, and you solve that problem, and that's okay, right? I mean, we don't have to solve the world's hunger on day one. We can start by, you know, feeding the homeless child in your neighborhood first. And that's what we need to do, to really solve the problem by narrowing it down, breaking it down into the smallest possible thing that we can realistically solve and that still has enough business value. Take that problem, solve it, deploy those applications, get the results, and slowly improve it, right? So the critical insight here is that, you know, kind of reset the expectations, really narrow the problem down to what is it that you want to solve, and solve it for that. Don't try to solve for the whole world. Although there are some of us who are trying to solve it for the general purpose problems, but it is still way too hard. And that applies to everybody, by the way. You take, I'll give some examples. You take, say, Google's speech to text or IBM speech to text. We fail on a lot of cases in different languages because it's too hard a problem. We just don't have enough data to learn a very good model that works on everything, right? So what is the solution for this? We have to get smarter and smarter with solving real problems and not try to be you know, the best for everybody. Question, comment?
Would AI also take in grammatical rules to kind of guess what somebody's saying? Like you're reading up by narrowing domains, blah, blah, blah. And the first season is like narrow dog brains. Would it somehow be able to contextually figure out what it should be?
So figure out the domain and use case based on what it is. But the thing is, a priori, if you don't set it to a goal, how do you know? It can learn. So I'll give you an example. That's a good question. You train a model for something, and you deploy it, and people start asking it specific kind of questions. And from that, you learn, hey, this AI model is being actually used for this type of thing more than this other type of thing. Maybe that's what it needs to be good at. And you take that data, you add labels to it, and you feed it, and you improve it over time, right? That's one way to solve it. But there is also a more existential question that you would have to ask yourself, saying, I built the model for this, people are using for that. Do I really want this model to be for that purpose or not, right? You may not want it to be for that purpose, but people may be finding an alternate use or whatever, and they're using it, but that may lead you in a direction that may not be what the direction that your business wants to go. And that happens a lot. You know, Microsoft released this bot, Taybot. I think many of you may have heard of it, and people, it's like you train your own language to it, and then people started training it racial slurs, and they had to shut it down, right? Now, does that mean just because people are, you know, kind of trying it for racial slurs, does that mean that you now have to make it good for being a good, you know, racial slur generator? No, I mean, that's not the business, that's not the direction you want to go, right? So you have to also be careful about where people will take you and where you want to go and see the misalignment and constantly keep that alignment for what you want it to be. How much time do I have? It's 7:20. Okay, for how long? Okay, all right. All right, so I went back to talk about this data pipeline. Okay, this is the most underappreciated pipeline in AI business. So these are the steps. Data, you collect the data, you select the data, you annotate it, label it, you enhance it or augment the data, synthetically generate data, and you check the quality of data. So there are many steps underneath each one of these. I won't go into it, but each one of these things require a lot of AI. It requires, you know, techniques. It requires processes, tools. But the key point is garbage in, garbage out, right? Data should be used for training. What data should be used for training requires careful selection and processes. And sometimes you may have to generate data synthetically. And this is happening. I will put it in the context. I mean, people are generating, you know, this works reasonably well in the case of images where you take cat. In a particular background, you change the background, you change the cat's rotation, rotate it, you change the directionality of it, and that gives you more data samples to make the model more robust, and that's happening. In text, it's a lot more harder problem, because if you take somebody's sentence and you want to generate multiple variations, paraphrased versions of sentences to make it more robust, it's much harder problem, because sometimes you end up actually changing the intent, and as a result, the system just gets very confused. But there are techniques for augmenting data. In the case of speech, you can add noise tracks in the background, make it more robust. So take a clean audio sample, add some, you know, train going in the background, people walking on the street talking, children playing in the background. Those kind of things makes the system more robust, because when people call in to call centers, they are not always in a pristine, clean environment. They're sometimes in their home environment. Kids are playing and shouting, yelling, and the system needs to be able to deal with all of that. So there are techniques for this augmentation that works well for some domains and not so for others. But anyway, so a lot of AI is needed to manage a data pipeline. And I talked about how you can accelerate learning or teaching of an AI system by scoping the problem. Now, I wanted to make the bridge and the connection to how it works for enterprises, right? AI for enterprises is messy. So you build, let's say, a good natural language understanding system and say, you know, it understands entities, it understands, it can recognize people, persons, and all that. Now you put it to a legal document like this, okay? It needs to understand, you know, the landlord has the right to do such and such. This is a rental agreement kind of document. Our tenant shall not assign, Landlord may impose rules. So it's talking about obligations. It's talking about, so you feed in this type of a document to a natural language understanding system, and you would, in an ideal case, you would want to be able to query this document, right? To say, what are the landlord's rights? What are the tenant's rights, right, or obligations? That's the question ideally you want to ask. Let it read this document, ingest it, apply all its entity recognition rules, this and that, and the relationships and all that. And you want to let the system come back with answers to those types of questions. That's the use case typically in enterprises when they feed these types of documents. But the systems that are trained on general purpose data start to trip horribly. So here are some of the examples. I mean, these are more context-based type of mistakes. This is some of the mistakes that a speech-to-text system makes. When a user says caller versus color with my Indian accent, actually, I cannot even say those things in a distinguishable manner. Or versus R, and the systems typically makes mistakes in this, but not just that. It doesn't understand domains. Let's say, you know, I put in some words like Infosys, and I tried a couple of speech engines, not only IBM's Watson, others, Google's and Mike Bing's as well. And for Infosys, it said emphasis. It could be my Indian accent, but hey, you know, I am an English-speaking person, so it better understand my accent, right? For AT&T, it translated it to it's empty. For Sanofi, it said sonography. And I put in this number 2244. Most systems trip here because it's a tricky one. For 3, it got it as 3, and 2244, it got that. These ones are always problematic because you write it as IEEE, and then you'll say it as IEEE, right? And so on. So there are lots of these real-world situations that come in, and not just that, this mortgage domain system needs to really understand that loan, not just that it's a noun or it's a an entity, whatever, but it really needs to understand what a loan means, that it has all this, you know, context behind giving loan has a giver, a taker, and it has an amount, and it has some expiration, and it's either approved or disapproved. There's a lot of ontology and actual domain knowledge behind it that the system can do a much better job of actually answering questions like, you know, what are the obligations of a loaner or a loan taker or a tenant or a landlord, that would do a better job of. So making it work for enterprises means, first of all, being able to take these OCR documents, optical character recognition documents, because not all of them may have been fully built in the original digital mode, and scanning them from PDFs and such to generate these types of actual text documents, then from that understanding these entities and relationships and having the context behind all these things, and then be able to have translate the query into intent and then answer the actual things from the document, right? So there's a lot of interesting things that have to happen, and along the way, all these kind of things that the system doesn't know about because it's in a new domain start popping up and it has to learn. So the way to make it work for enterprises is to teach it that particular domain by giving that data. I could have built a natural language understanding service system with whatever data that I have access to from general domain, news articles, public blogs, and this and that, but that won't help it to understand the legal domain. So it actually needs to be trained on legal domain type of data. If you take it and apply it to a legal domain example, okay. Oh, yeah. I also wanted to give you this example in the sentiment case, right? This happens a lot. We train sentiment model with general purpose data from tweets and that, and it learns that when people mention tickets, that it's something always in context where people got some kind of a driving violation ticket, parking ticket, or a speeding ticket. So it's usually expressed in negative context. So the model learned the word ticket to associate ticket with a negative sentiment. But when you take it to a call center domain, on first day, first call, it fails because the call starts with saying, my problem ticket number is such and such. And that's a neutral statement. Because that ticket is a very common word in call center domain, right? So it needs to learn that ticket is nothing wrong with the word ticket and the association for it to be more neutral than with anything else. And these are the kind of things that systems that are general purpose systems will trip when you take it to enterprises. Okay, best practice number 3, establish the purpose of the AI model. I think this kind of is very closely related to the point that I made that, you know, if you're trying to be good for everything, be for everybody, and there are genuine occasions or reasons where some companies are in that business, but most of the time you have to have clarity on what is the purpose of the AI model, right? If your purpose is to be a call center, if you are building an AI model for call center domain, then having that clarity and training really helps the data scientists who are building it to collect data corresponding to that and teach the system language and vocabulary corresponding to that. Actually, there are some statistics, I don't have them off top of my head, but something like more than 80% of the time is spent in everything from understanding the goals to collecting the data to preparing it to before you get to train. But much of the discussion today in academic papers really talk about this 20% of the AI pipeline as opposed to this. And by the way, this whole thing requires so much of innovation, invention, and needs AI itself in order to make that whole thing work. Okay, I think I've already mentioned this AI model isn't going to be perfect in first iteration. Build systematic model diagnostics, error analysis, model revision management into the process. So why is the model making a mistake? And where is it making a mistake? On what types of predictions it's making mistakes? And how of all the mistakes that it's making, how important is it that you fix certain types of mistakes more than certain other types of mistakes? That is, that having that clarity again is so important because you have only limited amount of budget, limited resources and time to put out the next iteration. So again, you cannot fix everything. You have to have a very systematic mechanism for understanding the confusion matrices, where the system is making, how is the competition doing, and where the system is actually biased in the statistical bias sense, but I'll also talk about the general bias type of things, but understand all of those things and very systematically go after fixing only those problems or errors that you care about that matter to the business and prioritize them. Not only, so in the previous one I said it's not going to be perfect in the first iteration. What that means is that it has to continuously learn over time. Any AI model has to learn. Even Roopnath's model that's going to predict that, give you that great red dress, is not going to get it right for everybody, right? So you learn from the mistakes that it makes, that you ask for feedback on users, and or you look at the clicks, or you look at the purchases, right, based on that, and you say, okay, well, maybe I didn't get the intent right, or this one was not accepted as a result, therefore I need to go back and analyze all that and say, is that because it didn't fit the preferences, or it didn't get the intent right, instead of asking. So that's a manual process. You sit with humans and say, look, I asked for a red beach dress, and what if it gave a Halloween dress, right? So that was a mismatch. Therefore, you know, you're going to say the model got it wrong. Okay, put it in this bucket. It gave some, you know, formal dress, whatever, you know, office wear. You put it in a bucket. So very clearly understand the types of mistakes, right? So it's a continuous process, though. I mean, it doesn't stop with one iteration, two iterations. It's a continuous process until you get to a point of some kind of a steady state or equilibrium where you say, okay, now my model, I'm comfortable with it. But I doubt that there will be such a thing because there will always be new somethings dynamically coming up. And so basically, it's a continuous. That's why the mission that I have at IBM Watson is AI operations. So it's all about really for our own Watson services, how do we continuously improve them? And it's a never-ending process. As long as they're up and running and alive and open for business, there has to be a process for managing them and continuously improving them. And that means this loop is so important, right? And how do you learn? You learn from your mistakes. That means you have to know, you have to log your payload data and all the queries that are coming into your system. And you have to then ask humans whether it got it right or wrong and take all those right or wrongs and feed it back and learn from that, right? It's no magic bullet here. Again, a lot of hard work. Okay, another important thing that comes up, trust, fairness, and transparency. To any AI conference you go to these days, AI summit, there will be a panel on AI and bias, I'll guarantee you that. And they will ask questions, they're debating questions on, you know, how do you trust, what are the ethics boundaries to these AI systems, you know, can you trust the predictions it makes? And there are two schools of thought or different schools of thought depending on what you look at. So, you know, do we ask our doctors how this medicine works when the doctor prescribes a medicine when we are sick? We just take it because we trust the doctor to know that this medicine works. So some argue, well, you know, explainability is not that critical as long as it works. Maybe that's okay in some domains, but it's not going to be okay in several domains. For example, if you are given a loan, if your loan is rejected and you file a case against the company, the investigators are looking at that loan rejection, they have to explain why they rejected the loan. They cannot just simply say that, you know, my system told me so, therefore I rejected it. No. What if the loan approval system is rejecting your loan for, you know, whatever reasons of bias that it learned, that just because you're of a particular age group or a particular gender or a race, it's just simply rejecting your loans? And can you just field such a system and say that, oh, I washed off, it's not my problem, it's that statistical system's problem? No, right? You're liable for it in that business. So it is important, the trust and fairness and the transparency. So in some situations and some domains like that, we have seen where companies actually make very interesting trade-offs. They let go of some amount of accuracy by not even including certain attributes as features in their model so as to achieve some fairness or have a better transparency. So for example, I have seen companies where they do no longer include age group in their loan prediction system as a feature. They just want it to be independent of the age of the, and that may or may not be the right thing, right? I mean, for the business of car driving insurance, age makes a lot of difference. The maturity of drivers makes a lot of difference, and that needs to be taken into account. But it's up to you, right? That's a business decision as opposed to a technology system making those decisions, right? So there are certain instances. But whatever the case may be, to achieve fairness, I have the following best practice. Set proper goals. So, and when the data scientists are building the AI system, tell them what is the goal for it. If you tell them the goal, how do you communicate the goal, by the way? Let's say the goal is for the system to recognize faces of people in the United States, not by name, but by, you know, age group, let's say gender. How do you describe that goal to a data scientist? A tradition in the past, or even now, the way it's being done is you tell the data scientist, Tim, I want an image recognition, face recognition system, the world's best one. Go build it. I would argue that that's very vague. Don't, if you are a data scientist, don't ever take such kind of directions from your product management teams because they don't know what they're talking about. You have to ask, okay, define the world's best. What all races, age groups, genders does it need to recognize? Do you have a taxonomy of it? Can you create a test case, a test case that I must pass when I build the model with a certain amount of accuracy? Let's say then the offering manager goes back and says, okay, I've looked at the United Nations race or gender taxonomy, taxonomy. Here are there are 25, how many of our races in the world. Do you want your system to recognize all of them? Probably no. You sit down and say, okay, what is this goal of this? You say, okay, these five races I want to be recognized in face, and these two genders, and these age groups. Then you say, now create a test data set for me with each representation of each one of those, and what is the accuracy that this model should be? Of course, if the offering manager say, I want 100% accuracy, obviously that may not be possible, but there has to be a minimum threshold, right? To see whether you want to deploy this or not, and whether the minimum threshold may be achievable, may not be achievable, whatever the case may be, but at least you are starting with some goal in mind, something very concrete. That is a reasonable goal to set, and now as a data scientist, you can now translate that into what type of data you need to collect, what type of model you need to build. Now, I'll give you this example. There was an article that came up in New York Times, spurred by a research paper that was done a few months ago. And it raked up a lot of interest in public media. This basically, the New York Times article pointed out, which was pointed out by the paper, that many of the image recognition softwares that are offered by top vendors does not recognize African-American women's faces. And in some cases, they were even classifying them as chimpanzees. And that was offensive, Of course it was offensive. But is it the mistake of the models? I would argue that that's not a mistake of the model. The model was built by data scientists who took whatever data they had access to. And there is not enough African American women's faces in the world that they could get from the data sets sources that they went to. And as a result, the model did not do a good job of learning to discriminate those types of images. So whose problem is it? At many levels, the process broke down in that case, right? If there was a goal that said recognizing African American women's faces should be part of, you know, your goal for the system, and it was in your test case, then the data scientists, as they are building the system, as they were testing it, would have detected that it doesn't do a good job of it, right? Whenever there is that such image, it does not do a good job. They would have caught it during the iterations of development cycle. So there are things we can do now in hindsight that would have prevented those types of things, and then in the future also these types of disasters will happen and they can be prevented by using best practices. And the best practices are you hold the business folks who are giving direction to build an AI model to define the target, to have a goal, and that goal has to be clearly articulatable and defined as part of a test data set. We were all taught as engineers when we build software systems that we have to build test cases first. Whatever happened to that, right? I am almost done, getting to wrap up. So build test cases first and set your goals and work backwards. And if the model, by the way, still could have biases because you could not collect enough data, whatever, declare your biases, be open. Like the nutrition labels, like the drugs have what ingredients they're built with, AI models, I would argue, should have these, you know, what data they're trained on, so you know as users what you're getting, right? So you can make those decisions on whether this is the right model for you or not. Don't just take the model and then later on find out that it doesn't do a good job of recognizing an African American women's faces and then be surprised by it. My training data set did not have enough of that and I declared it and you know it going into it, so there is no controversy there, right? And the continuously, the model drift and misalignment, I already gave that as an example to the question that one of you have raised, which is that you built a model for something, people are using it for something else, and you are taking all that data and constantly adding more labels and feeding it in, and it's changing what the model was for. Be aware of it. Whether or not that's what you want to do, consciously select and feed only the data that fits in with your goals and objectives of business case for what you want to do. If you're building a call center for a specific type of product problems, and if for whatever reason somebody gave you data for some other product, why waste your, you know, training time by feeding in that data if that's not what it's supposed to do, right? So be clear about it and monitor for those kinds of misalignments and drifts and so on. I won't spend time on it. Traditional software development cycle is very different from AI services, and there are many differences in roles, in how you're doing the testing, how what it means to be accurate, what it means to debug, what it means to have explainability. This is a whole talk in itself, and so I won't go into it. Finally, I would argue that there is a maturity scorecard that's required for AI, and in fact, we have written a paper about it, and organizations should ask themselves where they are across all these dimensions in building an AI model or an AI application and assess themselves on which level they're at, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the capability maturity model from software development practice, and consciously make efforts to go from one level to the other until they reach the most optimized level. And there are, and we have a more detailed set of this kind of a framework that we are going to be releasing to help companies to understand how to and what to do to build their own AI models with the levels of maturity that's required to have them be running in enterprise, in real world, and to do the right thing in terms of, you know, meeting their business requirements and all of that. So takeaways, these are the best practices that I've talked about to make AI work for enterprises. You know, manage your data pipeline thoughtfully, carefully. Accelerate learning by scoping the problem, narrowing the problem down. Establish the purpose for the AI model. Understand what it is. Write your test cases first. It's not going to be perfect in the first iteration. Make sure that you can iterate on it. Trust and transparency can be very important in some domains, and make sure that the models can continuously learn and monitor for drifts and misalignment so that you know it is still built for what it is. Yeah, and I already talked about the differences. Be aware of it. And the, not only the model maturity, the process maturity is just as important. That's why I introduced this AI maturity framework, and so that organizations can build them in a consistent, reliable, measurable manner with quality, so that it's not just for one model and you stumble upon the same set of things again for building the next AI model. Because as days go by, more and more companies will deploy more and more AI applications, and that's just how it's going to be. And our future is going to be a very different world than what we are in, with so many more AI applications. And the way to get there is in a scalable, repeatable, consistent, quality manner. And only the way to get there is by monitoring your process of building those things and taking those lessons learned and applying it to everything else that you're building. Otherwise, you'll be relearning the whole thing over and over again. Anyway, that's it for my talk. I'll open it up for any questions, or observations, comments. Well, you know, everybody's welcome, entitled to their own opinions and welcome to express their own. But for me, there is so much that we can do and we have to do before we talk about doomsday scenarios, right? All the examples that I gave are real practical examples that we can do today and really help ourselves and human society along the way, be it chatbots where people don't have to wait in queue or for phone queues just to get simple answers done, or be it doctor's assistants where doctors in remote parts of the world can get access to the best treatment options and plans that the most knowledgeable and advanced techniques are discussing and doctors have found, or to have more personalized set of recommendations for what we want to do in our lives, or to even have driverless cars where, you know, there are fewer accidents on the road. There are so many things that we still have to do to optimize to help ourselves, the society and humans along the way, that for me as a practitioner, I'm not even thinking about the doomsday. That's too far out for me. Who knows, we will get there someday or not, but I don't care. I may not be living at the time. You know, through my lifetime, there is enough things that I can do and we all can do that will help human society, that let's focus on that first, right? Yeah. Speech to the, applies to speech to text.
That refers to starting from scratch, right?
Yes.
But if we are building a domain specific model, we probably are building it on top of a general model, right? So, what would the estimated training size be? It won't be 10,000, right?
No. You probably don't need 10,000 hours. You know, anywhere from, you know, 1,000 to 2,000 to 3,000, depending on it, could be a decent starting point, probably. And then you can start to add, you know, how many hours, hundreds of hours that you get from a specific client domain to start to improve that model. And that's the key point, right, with that base model to narrowing the domain part, that if you still have to have all 10,000 hours, then we miss the point of then the barrier to entry and to make these AI systems work for everybody is just way too high. And that means we are trying to solve the problem. So you take any, say, like Google speech to text, IBM speech to text, the APIs as they are made available are expected to work for everybody. You know, but they will actually not work for many domains very well when you actually take them, because they are so general purpose. And even in the general purpose thing, there will be many corner cases where they won't work very well. It's just the nature of the problem. But yeah, I mean, that's to build on top, you need a smaller amount.
Just wasn't specific, it wasn't good training for the phonemes, or is it that
Yeah. So it's not that the phonemes are broken. The phoneme set for a given language is a finite set, and linguists define that. But the way it's said is different, right? So the accents are different. So in this particular case, the system needs to be able to map the audio, the spectrogram, and the frequency of the wave with a given phoneme. Eventually, the set of the words that we have to transcribe from all kinds of accents is the same. It's the same finite set of words in a given language. So the language model is the same. The phonemes are the same, but the accents are very different. So the problem is really from mapping those accents from audio files to these set of phonemes. So the phonemes is not, but the accents and the sounds that translate to all these from different. See, okay, you have to have enough occurrences of all the words that are spoken that the system needs to end with in all different variations and contexts of the words that come before it, the words come after it, so that the system can learn the patterns, right? So it's not just the same set of standard phonemes, and they come in different combinations of words, those phonemes, and that's the one that the system needs to learn.
I think there was one question over there.
One here. Yeah. Yeah, so there are multiple ways to deal with it. You take the base, and for every customer, you go in and take their data and build a new model, and that stays in their instance only. This base is not changing. That's one option, right? In some cases, the customer or you got some additional data that you can actually bring back to the base. And you can do that, but you have to consciously do that, because if that data, additional data that you're getting is in a very specific domain, then you're starting to add more and more data to this base that is pertaining to that specific domain. So now the base is becoming more geared toward a particular domain as opposed to general purpose base. So these are all decisions that you have to make to see whether you would want to put them back in the base or not. Some amount of it you would, because if you have access to it. If it is, many times actually clients don't give you their data to improve your base that you are selling commercially to everybody else, right? You bring your base as the commercial product, and the clients bring their own data and say, my data is my data. And you train it, and that model belongs to them only. Yeah, then we have to push. Yeah, exactly. So it's exactly like any other software updates, right? SAP system, on version 1, they'll release version 2, and they'll give you some time to say, we'll stop supporting this version 1, so you have to upgrade. That means in many cases, if you have written a lot of customization code, you'll have to now rewrite all of that on top of this, right? So, but thankfully, now it's not rewriting code, retraining with data. So the system will do it. You are not doing it. One last question, I guess.
Yeah. I just want to clarify the gentleman's question about DARPA. I was the one who led Bell Labs research, not with all these newer technologies and newer speeds and virtual machines and etc. Did not exist. I did for 5 major agencies. We called it audio processing, where the degree of difficulty was the noise level. That's the most difficult thing. In addition to what you said as the accent and et cetera, the noise level is
nice, yeah.
Some defense audit applications, that's going to be the difficult one. So it's a different segment. You should look at it, do detailed research. You can have transport from one to that.
Yeah.
You know, NIST has some of those, what you're trying to do.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Rama, thank you very, very much. This was wonderful. By the way, folks, I mean, I have been interacting with Rama for the last 1 month or so, but this is the first time I saw her. I had seen her at the Thai event, and she was on the panel, and I saw her. I said, okay, yeah, we would like to have her. And when I invited her, I was almost 90% sure that she's going to say no, because, you know, she is one of the influential people by Forbes magazine, Fortune magazine, and things like that. But I just told her that this is what our aim is, to objective is to democratize and to demystify AI, and she was absolutely ready for it, and she was very flexible with her dates and everything. So thank you very much, and thank you very much for highlighting all the challenges of before you even train the. I mean, you know, first thing I thought was okay, training the model itself is the big thing. But yes, before that itself, there are 100 steps to be taken care of. So thanks for highlighting that. And as a token of appreciation, we would like to give this thing to you, a souvenir from Hacker Dojo, on behalf of Hacker Dojo. The thing about this particular souvenir is everything on this souvenir has been made over here. As we mentioned, this is a
3D printing?
Yes, this is a maker space over here. We have a laser cutting machine over here. So one of our members, Scott Landon, he designed the whole thing. He did the laser cutting, he did the engraving and things like that. So everything was made over here, other than the wood that we got from Home Depot. So yes.